Hi, my name is Alistair Coleman. I'm a first-year student at Curtis and the composer of the next piece, titled February House for Solo Horn. Whenever I think of the horn functioning as a soloist, one piece I always come back to is the Serenade for Horn, Tenor, and Strings by Benjamin Britten. I've always been a huge fan of Britten's music, and little did I know that the Serenade was among the first pieces Britten wrote after spending almost 3 years in America before returning home to the UK in 1942 as a conscientious objector to the war. And while Britten was in America with his partner, Peter Pears, they lived in this feverish communal home in Brooklyn with many young and aspiring American writers and creative types. So I really imagine this piece kind of precedes the Serenade. It's staged as a set of miniatures to capture this kind of cast of characters in the house. There's W.H. Auden presiding as a quasi-landlord, Carson McCullers working on her Southern Gothic masterpieces, Jane and Paul Bowles constantly arguing with one another, and even Rose Lee, who was a gypsy in New York, who went partying each night while working on her own novels by day. I want to say a huge thank you to Jack Bryant for being such a great collaborator over these past few months, and also to the composition faculty for all of their help on the piece. Hope you enjoy. Thank you.
My name is Nathan Bales, and the piece that you're about to hear is titled I Sat in the Rain with My Croissant. It was written for the harp and for my friend Claire Tai. And when I wrote it, I really was just trying to write something beautiful for the harp. I wanted to write something that was, you know, maybe nostalgic, maybe a little bit reminiscent of something that's vague. I want people to be able to relate to it in their own way, rather than a way that I thought of first. It was a lot of fun to write. I really love the harp as an instrument. And I hope that you have as much fun listening to it as I did writing it with my friend Claire. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Elizabeth Yunan. I'm in my final year at Curtis, and I'm speaking to you from Sydney, Australia. If you've watched previous Curtis Composers concerts before, you may be aware that I am currently writing a suite of fantasias for different solo instruments. We are now up to number 5 for solo oboe, which will be played by my great friend Mackay Gladden. This piece can be described as a composed out accelerando, that is, the music gets faster. However, this does not simply apply to just the tempo. It affects all musical parameters, both on the micro and the macro scale. Parameters such as pitch, dynamics, even the rate at which motifs are developed and are contrasted with juxtaposing material. All of these facets combine to create increasing tension and urgency. But the piece is also fun, energetic, and bright, and so I hope you enjoy listening.
Thank you. Pandemic trend akin to baking bread and unnecessarily sanitizing groceries, reading, or at least pretending to have read, Albert Camus' The Plague, seemed to be uncannily relevant to many people this past year. For me, this unerring resonance manifested as a return to and a rewriting of one of my very first pieces, a work based on the last paragraph of La Peste for solo trumpet, that conceptualizes the player as an actor reciting a soliloquy as if inventing its language from the internal environment of a deep subconscious. I am really fascinated with the idea of translation and its opposition to transliteration. It struck me that while great actors have the license to create a narrative arc, an improvisatory presence in the delivery of their lines and in the embodiment of their character, great instrumentalists, on the other hand, do not so frequently have the opportunity to interpret characterization and create subtext in their own solo repertoire. I was very curious about this divide between the role of the actor and the musician in interpreting a text. So creating several arbitrary phonetic systems for myself, such as the sound of a long A corresponding to a certain pitch, or the word and always being painted as a high accent in G sharp. I also interspersed more arguable semantic translation of the words throughout the score, so that the pacing is often melodramatic, trying to allow for the fullest range of expression in conveying the text, as if the instrumentalist is literally speaking through their instrument. For this digital version, I also added the presence of a distorted, spatialized, radio-like pronouncement of the speech underneath the trumpet's monologue to affect the appearance of a duet, which I think is much more satisfying in a year that has felt like a thousand of solitude. And as for the 500,000 and counting, let us not take their lives in vain. And let us ensure with our actions now and forever that all the viruses, unlike that of Camus, will not rouse up their rats again.
All right. Hi, my name is Elise, and I am the composer of the piece For Blurred Walls. In this piece, as with all the other pieces that I've written for this series, the other instrument in this duet is the room, which is an electronic track composed of sounds made by objects found in my bedroom, as well as sounds that I can hear from my bedroom from the outside world. So in this case, that would include bird songs, an airplane, a ceiling fan, as well as like a heating unit, among other things. So in the first piece in the series, the room acted as a conversational counterpart to the instrument. In the second piece, it acted as an echo chamber, and in this piece, it's definitely a more oppressive force, as the subject, through tears, can only see four blurred walls closing in around them in a tornado of solitude.